Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The SNP launched a skills strategy in 2007. During that launch and part of the strategy, they said this: a smarter Scotland is at the heart of everything we want to achieve for this country. Now, 17 years on, we've got the report card on the SNP's skills strategy. The OECD have published a report this week, and it says there were multiple barriers to developing skills in Scotland. It says the SNP government's engagement with employers is limited in outreach, and carers' agencies remain fragmented. In a damning conclusion, the OECD state the link between the SNP's skill policies and economic development is, and I use the OECD's word, weak. Weak. Does the First Minister agree with the OECD that his government's record on skills, after 17 years of the SNP being in power, is weak?
First Minister.
So obviously the government will look carefully at the OECD report, but I don't agree with that conclusion. The government has invested heavily in the skills sector over many years. Engagement with business is work which has been undertaken by a whole range of different organisations, not least of which by Skills Development Scotland, to make sure that we undertake skills audits in localities. And that involves engaging with employers to make sure that we understand the future skills needs of individual localities and to make sure that that is provided for by the skills and development system within Scotland. And obviously, when we look at the outcomes that have been achieved as a consequence of our investment, we see young people who are involved in record positive destinations as a consequence of their participation in skills development in Scotland.
Douglas Ross.
Sorry, First Minister, you can't just say you disagree with the outcome of a report, because the damning assessment of 17 years is this government has been weak on skills. And not surprisingly, the First Minister ended his answer speaking about young people in positive destinations. Yeah. They do that every year. They trumpet their success in young people going to positive destinations. But the OECD report, which I don't believe the First Minister has read based on his first answer, says that being in a positive destination shortly after finishing secondary school does not guarantee positive outcomes in the long run. It says we should be monitoring positive destinations not only after 3 months, but after 3 years and even beyond. Now, the SNP, in their manifesto of 2021, pledged a young person's guarantee that would ensure that everyone between 16 and 24 years old would have the opportunity for education, training and a job, or a job. So can the First Minister tell us how is that going? How many young Scottish people are currently economically inactive or not in education? How many?
First Minister.
I don't have that specific figure in front of me just now, but what I can tell Douglas Ross is that in a whole variety of different sectors, there is provision available for young people to participate in developing their skills, whether that's in the provision of college places around the country, whether that's through the provision of modern apprenticeships or the development of foundation apprenticeships and graduate apprenticeships, which are part of the reform programme the government has brought forward, or whether that's about making available university places where, of course, we find there are a record number of young people from Scotland participating in higher education. And, of course, much to my satisfaction and the satisfaction of the government and its policy objectives, a record number of young people from deprived backgrounds taking part in higher education. So I accept that we always have to keep these issues under review. That's why we commissioned the Withers Review, and which were taking forward the reform of post-school education as a consequence of that work, to make sure that Scotland's skills system meets the needs of not only the population of Scotland, but also the businesses of Scotland, and supports our approach to investment in our country as well.
Douglas Ross.
Well, if I thought it after the first answer, I'm certain after the second that the First Minister has not read this extremely important OECD report, which is damning on his government's failure over 17 years. And the First Minister also said there that he was satisfied with what's happening. I'm not satisfied that he can't come to this chamber and answer a simple question. So let me tell him. The answer that he should know, as First Minister and a former Education Secretary, is 52,700. 52,700 young Scots aged between 16 to 24, economically inactive and not in education. Why should the First Minister know that? Because it is 1 in 10 of 16 to 24-year-olds, and it is the highest number ever on record. The highest number ever. I would have thought the First Minister would have been aware of that. The Young Persons Guarantee was launched by John Swinney when he was Education Secretary. And just a few weeks ago, the Minister in charge of the Young Persons Guarantee said its work had now been mainstreamed across government. If you strip away the ministerial jargon, it's clear that this complacent government thinks that the job is done. Yet these alarming figures, I remind the First Minister, the highest ever on record, tell a very different story. So isn't it the case that the Young Persons Guarantee is yet another broken SNP promise?
First Minister.
No. What it is that we take ideas and projects and we make them available right across the country. So that in every... Because the Young Persons Guarantee... Well, the Young Person Guarantee started off as a proposition within the City of Edinburgh. A tremendously good idea brought forward, led by Sandy Begbie of Scottish Financial Enterprise, and it was a very, very, and partnered with the City of Edinburgh Council, is a very good proposition. We listened to that learning and we applied that across the country. That's the right thing to do. Now, the problem with the statistics that Douglas Ross puts to me, of course, is that in the most recent economic inactivity data that's available, there was a significant fall in economic inactivity in Scotland and an increase in economic participation. Now, these are challenging issues, and the work on tackling economic inactivity is fundamental to encouraging economic participation, but it commands the focus of government to make sure that we maximise the number of people taking part in the labour market and participating in Scotland's economy.
Douglas Ross.
The real problem with the figures is Scotland's First Minister doesn't know that 52,700 16 to 24-year-olds are economically inactive and not in education. The highest ever on record. That is the problem, and that is what John Swinney should be focusing on. Now, the OECD are not alone in highlighting how weak the SNP are in delivering for young people. Today, Audit Scotland issued a damning verdict on their funding cuts to Scotland's colleges. The SNP's underfunding of our college sector has left many institutions with a bleak and uncertain future. And Audit Scotland predict the situation is only going to get worse with further job losses and rising financial deficits. So under the SNP, we have a skills strategy that doesn't help people get jobs, an education reform agenda that doesn't lead to any reforms, colleges that are going bust, and a young person's guarantee that doesn't guarantee anything. So how is John Swinney, as First Minister, going to do a better job with any of this than John Swinney did as Education Secretary?
First Minister.
President Officer, obviously I'm very familiar with the contents of the Audit Scotland report this morning, and the Audit Scotland report highlights the challenges that exist within the public finances. And the government is of course supporting the college sector with £750 million worth of investment in the current financial year. And I welcome that commitment because that's been delivered against the backdrop of a really difficult financial climate for the public services, which have been created by the economic mismanagement of the public finances by the last Conservative government, of which Douglas
Ross... Let's hear the First Minister.
..of which Douglas Ross was a loyal foot soldier who wanted me to follow the budget of Liz Truss. So the problem that Douglas Ross has got is that he perpetually comes along to this Parliament asking me to spend more money... Mr Ross perpetually comes along to this Parliament asking me to spend more money He asked me to spend more money last week on peak rail fares. He asked me to spend more money on free school meals for primary 6 and 7 pupils. He's now asking me to spend more money on colleges when he will not...
I would ask those members, and I am aware of whose voices I can hear from here, to resist the temptation to contribute at this point. You have not been called to speak. First Minister.
Presiding Officer, Mr Ross last week asked me to spend more money on free school meals, to spend more money on peak rail fares, and today he wants me to spend more money on colleges at the same time as he wants me to reduce tax and take £1.5 billion out of the public finances and support the Liz Truss economic madness which has inflicted misery on our country. I am going to listen to nothing Douglas Ross says to me in his remaining couple of weeks because his record is one of absolute abject economic failure.
Question number 2, Anna Sarwar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yesterday, John Swinney admitted that his party has spent too long focusing on what they can't do rather than what they can do. So let's look at one area where they have full control and the consequence of their failure to focus, our NHS. On their watch, 1 in 6 Scots on an NHS waiting list, cancer treatment standards missed, almost 5,000 children waiting for mental health treatment, dental waits of 3 years and cuts of over 1,100 nursing jobs since the start of the year when we already have staff shortages. Our NHS staff have been left at breaking point. So can I ask the First Minister if he knows how many working hours were lost to NHS staff absence last year?
First Minister.
President Officer, in relation to the National Health Service, I would be the first to accept that there are challenges in the National Health Service which are a consequence, and we all can't deny this, of the pressures that are now applied in the National Health Service as a consequence of the COVID pandemic. And we are still, as is every other health system in the Western world, wrestling with the challenges that come from that period. But what I can say to Mr Sarwar is that the latest figures show that there has been an increase in inpatient and day case activity year on year, 9.9% increase in the inpatient and day case activity. There's been a 2.7% increase in outpatient activity. In relation to planned care, there has been an increase in capacity as a consequence of the introduction of the national treatment centres, with 20,000 additional surgeries underway, with a range of different interventions. And on cancer treatment, which Mr Sarwar mentioned, we're treating more patients with cancer on time within the 62-day standard, 3% more compared to the same quarter a year ago, and 12.8% compared to 10 years ago. So what that is a story of is of the National Health Service, our committed staff, the length and breadth of the country, doing everything they can to ensure that we meet the needs of individuals in very difficult and challenging circumstances, and that will remain the focus of the government.
Anna Sarwar.
The fact of the matter is NHS waiting lists are getting longer, not shorter, on this government's watch. And the answer the First Minister was looking for is over 15.3 million hours. 15.3 million working hours in a single year lost in the middle of an NHS crisis. That is the equivalent of 640,000 days lost in our NHS when 1 in 6 Scots are on an NHS waiting list. And this has real consequences. Take the experience of Karen Campbell, an NHS dental nurse for 25 years who's been forced to quit after waiting years for prolapse and hip surgery. Karen just wanted to get back to the job she loved, but couldn't due to her untreated condition. And Karen said this, "It would have been so much easier if they'd fixed me up and kept me working, but now I feel let down. I still appreciate the NHS, but my experience shows how broken the system is." So can the First Minister explain why an NHS dental nurse is being forced to quit due to NHS waiting lists when we have NHS staff shortages and an NHS crisis?
First Minister.
I obviously very much regret the circumstances that Anna Sarwar puts to me about Karen Campbell's case, because obviously it's in the interest of the National Health Service for individuals to be, who are their employees, to be treated timorously, as it is in all walks of economic life, to make sure people can get back to their work. So I accept fundamentally the importance of the point that's put to me. But there are legitimate challenges that have been wrestled with about the amount of, about the demand on services and the impact as a consequence of increased demand arising out of the COVID pandemic. Now, what the government has done, of course, has been to expand the staff resources within the National Health Service over a number of years. So if we look at nursing and midwifery staffing, it's up 17.5% since this government came to power. On medical and dental consultants, we have seen a 68% increase in the number of medical and dental consultants that have taken place, now, that have been recruited since this government came to power. So the government has been investing. We obviously have taken decisions to allocate more investment than would have been the case if we just passed on Barnett consequentials, because we've been prepared to take the decisions which Mr Sarwar no longer supports about taxation, yep, so that we've got more resources available in the National Health Service. And, of course, one of the key interventions of the government has been to make sure that at all times we focus on maximising the number of staff that we have available, despite the challenges of increasing demand in the service.
Mr Sarwar.
15.3 million working hours lost in 1 year in our NHS, and that's the answer from the First Minister. Simply not good enough. Because Scots deserve an NHS that is there when they need it. But under this SNP government, even our NHS staff can't get the treatment they need in time so they can get back to work and treat others. So what this has created is a doom loop of delays where everyone loses out. And the simple truth is that our NHS is not safe with the SNP, and no amount of warm words will cut it. The record shows they can't be trusted. Because this is a government that has lost its way, is incompetent, and now admits that it has spent too long focusing on campaigning rather than governing. So why are NHS patients and staff being forced to pay the price of this SNP government's neglect?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, there are challenges in the National Health Service, and there's not an occasion when I'm questioned on this subject that I don't accept that point. But there's also a couple of realities that have to be wrestled with. The first reality is the increased demand that is created as a consequence of the COVID pandemic. And our health service staff are working as hard as they possibly can do, and I admire them for all they're doing to try to deal with that situation. But the second is the financial context in which we are operating. And this government has taken some pretty difficult decisions to increase the money that's available to the National Health Service so that we can, for example, afford pay deals so that we avoid industrial action, which has been one of the elements of sustaining the National Health Service, which has been so important in Scotland. And I welcome the positive dialogue that has taken place. But of course, the problem here is the perpetuation of austerity. And Mr Sarwar told me during the election campaign there would be no austerity under Labour. Now, Mr Sarwar can try... Mr Sarwar can make all the gesticulations he wants at me. Those were his words. No austerity under Labour, and we're getting austerity under the Labour Party as we speak. So my message to Mr Sarwar is if he wants
Members.
To help the situation, he should say to his UK masters, end the austerity, because as he well knows, all roads lead back to Westminster on NHS funding.
Question number three, Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister when the Cabinet will next meet.
First Minister.
The Cabinet will next meet on Tuesday, Presiding Officer.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, last night I chaired a packed town hall meeting in South Queensferry. For 4 years, my constituents have had their quality of life destroyed by hundreds of high-performance, illegally modified cars and motorbikes racing around their beautiful town. The drivers of these vehicles will abuse and intimidate anyone who approaches them where they gather in the car park at the foot of the iconic Forth Bridge. Pets have been killed. Hotels have lost trade. Nobody is getting any sleep. Residents like pensioner Andy Scott are really worried about road safety. In fact, Just as our meeting was concluding, there was a collision right outside our venue with a motorcyclist rushed for hospital. Police are appealing for information about that. The racing and the antisocial behaviour is happening in Inverness, parts of Glasgow, Crail, many other areas. Will the First Minister meet with me and agree to establish a national task force to establish and examine what more can be done to address this criminal behaviour that is blighting so many lives?
First Minister.
First of all, President Officer, I'm very sorry to hear the circumstances in South Queensferry. It is a beautiful part of our country, an iconic location, and I'm sorry that members of the public are experiencing what they are experiencing. The Government obviously engages substantively on the question of road safety. The Transport Minister has been briefing Cabinet about her concerns about road fatalities, which is a very serious and current problem. So that issue is very much on the Cabinet's agenda. I'm very happy to have discussions with Mr Cole Hamilton on this subject and to determine what further action can be taken. Obviously, the incident that Mr Cole Hamilton has raised last night will involve police interaction, and I'm sure the police will have been involved in other instances of this kind. So I'm very happy to host those discussions to see what more can be done to address that situation. There may be some legislative issues that may be worth considering. I fear some of those will not be within our areas of responsibility because of road traffic issues, but I'm very happy to explore all possibilities.
Question number four, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the implications are for public health in Scotland of the UK Government's announcement that it plans to ban junk food advertising before 9 p.m.
First Minister.
President Officer, improving diet and reducing health inequalities remains a public health priority for this Government. We know that food advertising is significantly skewed towards food which is high in fat, sugar or salt compared to healthier options such as fruit and vegetables. This is why the Scottish Government has long advocated for restrictions on the broadcast advertising of less healthy food and drink to children before 9 p.m. I welcome the announcement that the United Kingdom Government intend to introduce these restrictions next year.
Emma Harper.
Thank the First Minister for that response. I've been closely following the work of food experts Henry Dimbleby and Dr Chris Van Tulleken regarding ultra-high processed foods and foods which are high in fat, sugar and salt. And I'm aware that the Scottish Government has been calling on such a move from the UK Government, but can the First Minister comment specifically on whether he believes this move will help to address issues such as childhood obesity, and can he provide an update on how this work will complement the Good Food Nation Act?
First Minister.
So the Scottish Government remains committed to using the latest scientific consensus of established evidence to inform our view on ultra-processed foods. Many ultra-processed foods are high in fat, sugar or salt, which can contribute to diet-related conditions. However, some foods classed as ultra-processed, such as whole grain breads and breakfast cereals, can be consumed as part of a balanced diet. We continue to endorse a healthy, balanced diet as represented by the Eat Well Guide. This guide will support progress to achieving our Scottish dietary goals and complements our vision for Scotland to be a good food nation where people from every walk of life can take pride and pleasure and benefit from the food they produce by cook, serve and eat each day. And obviously there's very significant issues and opportunities within the education system to enable a deep understanding of the nutritional value of particular types of food.
Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is welcome that the UK Government has hit the ground running and delivering on its Child Health Action Plan, including its taking action on childhood obesity. Given that a recent Scottish Health Survey found one third of Scottish children are at risk of being overweight, does the First Minister accept the action from the UK Government as an opportunity to act with urgency to use the devolved powers that we have here in Scotland?
First Minister.
The issues that Carol Mockin raises are very much at the heart of the Government's response and intervention on these questions. The approach taken by the United Kingdom Government is welcome, as I have indicated, and it obviously complements many of the measures that we are taking and which are being progressed through the curriculum in Scottish education. So I think there is an opportunity to take forward the commitments that we have to ensure that people have a balanced, healthy diet, which is essential for individuals' well-being.
Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I listened to the exchange with the First Minister and Emma Harper there with interest, and he'll know my interest in improving nutritional standards in our country. There are two sides to this. There's obviously the side that Emma Harper has raised, but the other side is how do we promote healthy food? Does the First Minister agree with me the place to start is in our school meals system?
First Minister.
Well, I think the place to start is in the home and in our schools, and to make sure that everybody is aware of the nutritional value of food, and also of the dangers of some foods and the damage that can be done as a consequence. There is also the work that can be done to encourage an active lifestyle, which is very important. And just so that I can report to Mr Whittle that I was out running this morning, so and Mr Whittle is gesticulating to me that so was he, so I better put that on the record to protect his international reputation. And the fact that he's asked me this question gives me the opportunity to say that I welcomed his question last week about the Commonwealth Games, and I do hope he welcomes the announcement that was made by the Government on Tuesday of our support to the work of Commonwealth Games Scotland, which is perhaps a very visual signal of the opportunities to lead a healthy and active lifestyle by having the Commonwealth Games in Glasgow in 2026.
Question number 5, Tim Eagle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to reports that Transport Scotland has spent more than £16 million on consultancy fees in relation to the A83 Rest and Be Thankful project.
First Minister.
The Government remains absolutely committed to keeping Argyll and Bute open for business, and we're acutely aware of the importance of the A83 to the communities and the economy of the area. That is why we're delivering a range of measures in the short, medium and long term to reduce the risk of impact of landslides at the Rest and Be Thankful. This funding will help us to achieve this. The costs incurred reflect the complexity and challenges of the scheme and cover essential assessment, survey and development work, allowing the project to progress at pace.
Tim Eagle.
Last Sunday, the A83 was once again closed, and I am told by a constituent yet again this morning. In the 17 years that this SNP government has been in office, it hasn't just neglected the A83, but the A82, the A9, the A96, I could go on. Residents and businesses are beyond exasperated. Whether it's ferries, R100, hospital projects or the A83, am I to assume that the neglect shows that this government just doesn't care about rural Scotland?
Yep.
So can I ask again, can the First Minister confirm when the works on the A83 and at the Rest will actually commence?
First Minister.
President Officer, the first thing I want to say is that the work that's been undertaken by On the Rest and Be Thankful, and the work that is the focus of Mr Eagle's question, is essential work to make sure we can have a long-term solution to what's an extremely challenging route. And anyone that's driven the A83 will know just how challenging the route is because of the exposed nature of the route. On the 15th of September, there was a movement on the hill which resulted in 500 tonnes of material coming down and closing the A83. The measures the government has taken to put in place the alternative route of the old military route avoided an extensive detour, which is a very lengthy detour. There are no other alternatives in place. And that's a measure of the approach the government has taken to try to make sure Argyll and Bute remains connected at all times. Now, Mr Eagle went through a whole range of different issues there, and I would simply point out to him that, for example, on the R100 contract on digital broadband is a reserved responsibility of the United Kingdom Government and rural...
Members.
And rural Scotland is connected only because of the investment of the Scottish Government. So, and of course, on roads like the A9, for example, we have completed the Lunkerty to Passaburnham stretch. We've completed Kincraig to Dalrady. We've concluded the Cruben Moor stage. We've just concluded the tendering process, which will start on site of Moy to Tomatin. All of these developments are underway. Why do the Conservatives moan about everything?
Evelyn Tweed.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think the Tories are missing the point here. The A83, rest and be thankful, is a vital route in Argyll and Bute. Road users want to know how the permanent solution being devised by the Scottish Government will benefit them. Can the First Minister set out some detail?
Let's hear Ms Tweed.
Can the First Minister set out some detail in this regard?
First Minister.
Well, Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is taking forward the improvement work at the A83. There is a task force that is supervising this work. It will meet with the Transport Secretary. The Transport Secretary leads the task force, and they will meet this afternoon as part of the routine work that is underway to make sure that the permanent solution improves the resilience and operational safety of the route, which is designed to improve access to employment, education and healthcare services and to protect the interests of the people of Argyll and Bute, which matters very significantly to the Government.
Question number 6, Ross Greer.
Thank you. To ask the First Minister what the Scottish Government's response is to the decision by Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park regarding the Flamingoland Lomond Banks planning application.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I am aware of the decision made by Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park Authority Board to refuse planning permission for a development at West Riverside and Woodbank House in Balloch. Given the applicants have a right of appeal, which could potentially come before Scottish Ministers in the future, it would not be appropriate for me to make any further comments.
Ross Greer.
Thank you, and I appreciate the First Minister's answer and the constraints. I had to lodge this question a few hours before the decision was made. I'm delighted by the unanimous rejection of the Park Board after a decade of attempts by Flamingoland to force this daft mega resort on Balloch. Over 154,000 people joined our campaign and objected. They were joined by the Woodland Trust, Ramblers, the National Trust for Scotland and SEPA. But at its core, this was a community campaign, and my constituents in Balloch and the Howden want to turn the page. I've written to the First Minister to request that the Scottish Government terminate Flamingoland's exclusive contract with the government agency who own most of the site. This agreement was renewed after their first failed application in 2019, and it's the key reason this threat has hung over the people of Balloch for a decade. It's what has prevented more appropriate development proposals from coming forward. So can I ask the First Minister, will the Scottish Government end rather than renew this agreement, and will they review the use of exclusivity agreements and the impact they have on communities like Balloch?
First Minister.
There's two elements to the question that Mr Greer raises, which I understand entirely why he's raising them with me. The first relates very specifically to the Flamingoland development, and I better not say anything specific about that for the reasons about the potential appeal that could come forward. The second point is about the provision of exclusivity agreements in principle. And there will, of course, be mixed opinions on this, but some of the purpose of exclusivity arrangements can be to accelerate planning developments which, in other circumstances, many of us might approve of. So, for example, renewable energy developments might be speeded up as a consequence of exclusivity arrangements that can be arrived at. So I'd simply say that we have to take we've got to have a broad view of these questions, and because there may be developments and opportunities which are beneficial in the national interest that could be supported by moves of that type. But I hear Mr Greer, and the points he's made, which are important, are on the record today.
Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was pleased with the decision to reject the planning application for Flamingoland. From day one, I was against these plans, and as it was clear to me that too many local residents were concerned by the impact that Flamingoland would have had on them. Therefore, does the First Minister acknowledge the importance of planning decisions considering the views and concerns of local residents?
First Minister.
That should be an essential part of any consideration of the planning process. And indeed, it is in the interests of all parties, whether it's the interests of communities or developers, to actually have good community engagement. Because if there is good community engagement, it is, in my experience, more likely that developments will be enabled if community concerns and interests have been properly taken into account in the thinking of the development propositions that are brought forward.
Jackie Bailey.
The First Minister will be aware that there is a clause in the exclusivity agreement that allows Flamingoland a further year to obtain planning permission. Now, that's either going to be through an appeal or through a fresh application, neither of which can be achieved in that time frame. So will the First Minister therefore end the exclusivity agreement now, or at the very least, not extend it?
First Minister.
I think Jackie Bailey, and I understand her interest in this question, encourages me to get into the specific issues that could be material to any appeal that could come in front of ministers. And I have to be, and Jackie Bailey has long enough experience in this Parliament to know I have to be very careful not to prejudice the position of Scottish ministers. But I hear what she said, and the government will, of course, consider all relevant issues when any issues that potentially come to ministers have got to be addressed.
Thank you. We move to constituency and general supplementaries, and I call Christine Graham.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First, I declare an interest as the Golden Eagle champion. Not many of you know that. The South of Scotland Golden Eagles project in my constituency, which has increased the number in the South of Scotland from 10 to nearly 50 over 6 years, with relatively small calls on public money, has advised me it is at serious risk of closure at the end of the year unless it can access new sources of funding. Will the First Minister look into this to ensure this valuable project, increasing the numbers of this iconic bird population, can continue?
First Minister.
President Officer, the South of Scotland Golden Eagle project is a very successful project. It began in 2018. When there were only between 4 to 8 golden eagles across Dumfries and Galloway. There are now more golden eagles in South Scotland than at any time recorded in the last 200 years. I hear the issues that have been raised by Christine Graham, and I'll ask the Rural Affairs Secretary to discuss with Christine Graham and the project what steps can be taken to try to secure its future.
Briggs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. On Tuesday, NHS Lothian announced urgent major repair works will have to be undertaken on the Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion. All patient appointments scheduled from October 28th will be moved, and it's now expected to be 6 months before the hospital can reopen. In 2014, the current Eye Pavilion was declared not fit for purpose. There is now real anger at this latest situation and demonstrates yet again the need for a new eye hospital. Ministers need to take responsibility. They have cancelled a new hospital now on 2 occasions. So can I ask the First Minister if he will personally meet with campaigners and cross-party MSPs to get the replacement hospital back on track?
First Minister.
I think I appreciate the anxiety that will be felt because of the issues in relation to the Eye Pavilion in Edinburgh. The Health Board is working, and we expect the Health Board to work, to make sure that there is no diminution of the service and the support that's available to patients, to ensure that they can have their needs met. Obviously, there are capital funding pressures which the government is wrestling with. Mr Briggs will be familiar with all the statements that have been made by the Finance Secretary about the reduction in capital expenditure that has taken place, and that has had a consequential effect on our ability to afford projects, combined with the very significant increase in construction costs which has arisen because of sky-high inflation. Now, these are the realities that we're wrestling with, and I assure Mr Briggs that the Government is doing everything that we possibly can do to deliver that capital programme, but we cannot deliver that programme as timorously as we would like because of the effect of inflation and the cuts to the capital budget. But I assure him that the Government is focused on finding solutions to these challenging issues.
Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the First Minister knows, I played a part in helping establish the Aberdeen Hydrogen Project. So I'm very pleased to hear this week of £7 million of Scottish Government funding to kickstart green hydrogen projects in Scotland. Can I ask the First Minister what more we can do to support this industry and make it thrive? And would it not be better if we had all of the economic levers of power to drive forward our net zero agenda?
First Minister.
President Officer, I agree with Kevin Stewart, and I welcome very much the initiative he took to encourage the development of the green hydrogen project in the north-east of Scotland. Yep. It is a very significant economic opportunity for Scotland, and I want to make sure that Scotland is able to realise the benefits of our enormous energy generation potential. Obviously, the focus of the government on the development of renewable energy, offshore wind resources particularly, will help to develop the hydrogen sector, and that will contribute towards the strengthening of the economic well-being of Scotland. And I expect to discuss many of these issues at the Scottish Energy Advisory Board, which I will co-chair tomorrow, to take forward many of these developments.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister will be aware that the Scottish Legal Advisory Board is removing funding for legal advisers from citizens' advice bureaus across Scotland. Within island communities like the Western Isles, the removal of these posts will have a disproportional impact, as there are no alternative free sources of legal advice with expertise on local issues such as crofting. This service will be lost next month. Can I ask the First Minister, even at the 11th hour, can he intervene and save these vital jobs and services?
First Minister.
I'll look closely at the issue that Rhoda Grant puts to me. This was an issue that we touched on at the conveners group yesterday when I was questioned by parliamentary committee conveners about the, and I think the question was put to me by my colleague Karen Adam, the convener of the Equalities Committee, who was raising the question of the access to the distinctive needs of island communities in accessing services where there is no other tangible alternative available. So Rhoda Grant comes directly into that territory with the question she raises about those services. So I'll take that point away. I undertook to the conveners group yesterday to reflect on some of these questions and the availability of services, and I'll take that point away that Rhoda Grant has raised with me, and I'll write to her in due course.
George Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A report by economists at Aston University has warned that the UK's Brexit deal has caused a sharp decline in UK-EU trade and is likely to get worse. Does the First Minister share my concerns that the UK Labour government is intent on ignoring this evidence of the harm that Brexit is doing to our economy? And does he agree that the best way to improve our economic outlook would be for us to rejoin the EU as an independent nation?
First Minister.
I am absolutely stunned that the UK political consensus now seems to accept the damage of Brexit is something that we just have to resign ourselves to. I saw a very impactful interview yesterday with Sir John Major, the former Prime Minister, in which he highlighted the deep and corrosive damage that Brexit has done to the economy of the United Kingdom, and it's had that effect on the Scottish economy, where it is more challenging for our businesses to trade with Europe and more challenging for us to benefit from the positive economic effects of free movement of the population. So I agree with Mr Adam. This issue has got to be addressed because the United Kingdom has inflicted on Scotland, who voted to stay in the European Union, significant economic damage, and the only way to reverse that is by Scotland becoming an independent member of the European Union.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This morning, the SNP government have caved into pressure from the Scottish Conservatives to abandon their misguided ban on wood-burning stoves, which would have stopped the installation of wood-burning stoves in new homes. Hundreds of constituents who rely on these heating systems have shared with me the harmful impact this ban would have, particularly those living in rural communities and those facing extreme winter conditions. Will the First Minister now commit to a permanent ban on the issue and the policy that he has brought forward, and will he also consider looking at the businesses who have been affected and offer them compensation for the job losses?
First Minister.
The government set out its position, and if Rachel Hamilton's response is a supposed welcome to the government agreeing with her, then I hate to see what her reaction would be if we said that we disagreed with her.
Michael Mara.
Officer. Yesterday, I met with the Chief Executive of the Mental Welfare Commission to discuss the condition of NHS Tayside's Strathmartin Learning Disability Unit. In the hour before our meeting, an overdue inspection report on the unit was released. The Dickensian conditions it describes include rats falling from ceilings, mould on walls, rainwater pouring through cracks, insect infestations and the stench of urine throughout. A Mental Welfare Commission report called for a decision as soon as possible, as far back as 2017. More reports followed saying the same. 2018, 2019, 2020, 2021, 2023 and 2024. David Strang's devastating reviews into mental welfare in Tayside have sat on government shelves for 4 years. Why does nothing ever, ever change?
First Minister.
I'm very familiar with this issue because I have constituents who are supported by the Strathmartin Centre, and I've engaged personally and directly on this question in my constituency capacity, which Mr Mara well knows. His characterisation of the response to the report by David Strang is not an appropriate characterisation. There have been update reports which have been given to local members of Parliament about the steps that have been taken to improve mental health services in the Tayside area as a consequence of Mr Strang's report. Now, as I set out in my response to one of the Conservative members on the to Miles Briggs, forgive me, on the issue of capital investment in Edinburgh, there are capital challenges in the health service. There are existing plans to relocate to a single site for learning disability services at Murray Royal Hospital in my own constituency in Perth. And I look to NHS Tayside to advance those proposals as sustainably as they can within the current financial context. But I don't think it's fair for Mr Mara to set out the characterise the report and the response in the fashion that he has.
Clare Haughey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite Anas Sarwar's promising voters no austerity under Labour, Labour MPs have voted to scrap the universal winter fuel payment, and the energy price cap is set to rise by 10%, causing fear and worry for pensioners in my Rutherglen constituency. Does the First Minister share my concern that Labour MPs have hammered the Scottish Government's spending ability by putting party before pensioners? Yeah. And does he agree with me that independence is the solution to avoiding yet another decade of Westminster austerity?
First Minister.
President Officer, I'm deeply concerned by the impact of the decision by the United Kingdom Government to abruptly end the universal provision of winter fuel payments to the pensioner population within the United Kingdom, which will result in 900,000 pensioners in Scotland losing access to their winter fuel payment. Now, the issues that this government faces, I would dearly love to be able to maintain that as a universal provision, but it will. Well, I'm being shouted at by the Conservative members that I can. So let me go back to where I left off with Douglas Ross. The Conservative members,
First Minister,
in the course of the last couple of weeks, have asked the government to spend more money on colleges, more money on free school meals, more money on peak fares, and more money on winter fuel payments than we will have, because our budget will be cut by 160.
Let's hear the First Minister.
Because our budget will be cut by 160 million by the Labour government as a consequence of these changes. And the Conservatives and the Labour Party, of course, want us to reduce taxation, which will further reduce the money that's available. So I am very much reminded in Clare Haughey's question by the commitment that Anas Sarwar gave the people of Scotland, and he gave it directly to me. There'd be no austerity under Labour, and we're now getting austerity under Labour, and Labour should be ashamed of themselves.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business is a member's business debate in the name of Sharon Dowie, and there'll now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and the public gallery to do so.